say that it's two main characters and they're doing a journey?
Yes. Those two guys are definitely moving. And they just are in that place at some point. Like as I said before, this guy right here, his name is Pulusimun. He plays the character, he is someone from Burkina Faso, trying to make it safely. And he is the inspiration for the film. He's a very good friend of mine. He and I moved in together about 5 years ago after we made a short film. So we decided we wanted to make a feature film. We decided to live together and work out the story. And we've been living there ever since.
But how did you meet him? Since he's sort of the character behind, or his story is behind the short film, you were here last year, and now his story is come to life in the feature film. So how did you meet?
We met, this thing happens in both films, and you guys will know what I mean afterwards. But there was this anniversary for this event that had taken place, and I had gone to casting for the short film. And when I got there, there were like 700 African immigrants who had all been in this town who were protesting something. Being very vague, I know, I'm just trying to take the talk. Thanks a lot. When I got to this place, I saw him right away. He was like standing in front of 600 people, like a megaphone in his hands, speaking like six different languages. He was really commanding the situation. So I thought to myself, okay, like, this guy has the charisma to move all of these people. Like, he's caught all of our eyes right away. Something tells me he can bring something to the screen. So I met him right after that. I said, hey, do you want to be in a movie? And he was like, no, I don't want to be in a movie. So that was the first challenge. And then after, we spent a lot of time sort of speaking about what it is we wanted to do with the film, and eventually we convinced him to participate.
Did he distrust you? I mean, did you have to gain his trust?
No, he was actually just really busy. He really was like at the head of this march, and at the end of this march, he had organized, like, 600 different African immigrants from all different countries, which is already a feat in itself, to organize people from all these countries into buses to go to another protest, like, a few hours away. So he was really, really wrapped up in this movement. So, for him, we were just, he thought we were just journalists trying to do a short story, and he was busy doing something much more important at the time. But then once we stayed, he realized that we weren't just there to do a quick news story, be in and out. Once he realized that we were committed to actually making a film in this town, he came around and eventually said yes.
You really stayed there, right? You went down there and now you lived there.
Yeah, I went down there 5 years ago to make a short film, and I still live there. And I don't exactly know how that happened. But it did, and I'm happy that it did.
Can we at least say which area of Italy it is?
Yes. it's a small town called Dragaro, which is right next to Rosarno, and it's all in Calabria. So if you think of the boot of Italy, it's like the toe of the boot. Or like as far south as you can get on midnight.
And so, from making this short film and then deciding to make it into a feature film, did you think of that already from the start, or how was that process?
No, originally, that's why it's so surprising to me that I still live in this town. I'd gone down there in 2010 after this event to make a film about this one specific thing that happened in the town. And then when I got there, so I met him. And immediately our friendship, because it was so hard to convince him, like in the process, we sort of became very, very good friends. And almost immediately after that, he told me his life story, and I knew that it could be adapted into something much, much bigger. The short story wasn't really getting to the root of what it's like to live as an African immigrant in a small town. So, what you're about to see on the screen, about 92.36% of it is 100% real. They're all things that happened to him. There are a couple other stories of friends of ours that we wanted to incorporate, but the through line in the story is his. It's his story.
So the story is authentic, and from my point of view, you seem to have tried quite hard to also make it look and feel authentic. Can you say anything about something about how you went about to meet him?
Yeah, we left with this idea that his story and his perspective would be enough to carry the film. So for us, it was very, very important not to editorialize it, not to become overtly didactic, not to incorporate all these things that we're hearing in the news nowadays. We want to let that fade into the background because, as you guys know just as much as anyone, new stories every single time. So the idea was for the verb to leave that behind and concentrate on one person living it. So, I mean, as you see, you know, the film has very little, like, context. It's all about him and the camera movement and the idea and the filming, is following that. It's trying to stay as closely connected to his point of view as possible.
And so you wanted to connect to one person and then sort of reach many.
Yeah. Yeah. Hopefully, by being specific, you can be universal. I forgot who said that. I didn't know.
Can you say anything more about, you know, the camera work and how you decided how to shoot?
Yeah, so, you know, it's hard because you guys have no idea what I'm talking about right now. But, you know, you'll notice that the film, you know, as I said before, is very, very close in perspective. Like, you stay very grounded in his POV for the most part. But outside of that, we also wanted things to feel very, very, very spontaneous. So we never wanted to give the idea that, you know, we'd like it at any moment that you could think it's a documentary, or any moment you could think these are things that are actually happening, because often things that happen in the film are things that happen to us in our real lives over the course of the last 5 years living in this town. So, you know, we wanted to blur that line between cinema and artifice and spontaneity, and hopefully our camera choices highlight that, exacerbate that.
You're saying that you wanted to disregard anything that happens right now all over Europe. But can you say, when did you shoot or finish the film? During which time period?
We finished the film premiered in May of last year. So almost a year ago, I guess. And we started shooting it the May before that. So the whole process from starting to shoot to ending to the end here. And I started writing it in 2011. I'm sure filming made in 2010.
So you stopped shooting in May 2014?
Yeah.
I'm asking just because I wanted to ask you how you feel. I mean, does it feel different to release the film now when there's so much awareness about the refugee situation all over Europe than what you went through when you started this whole project?
You know, it sort of goes back to what I was saying before, like our idea was so attached and grounded in one person's experience that we didn't think much, we weren't thinking about like the timing of it. You know, now, you know, in the interviews and other festivals, people are constantly saying this movie's perfectly timed, but we always felt that we were making the movie very, very late because we initially wanted to make the film in 2011. He migrated in 2008. So the more time that was passing that we weren't able to get the film off the ground, we felt like we were like losing our window to tell the story. So, you know, it's funny how it happens. Like, you know, your own country starts to care more about a situation when other countries care about it. Like all of a sudden, like other countries hold the mirror up to what's happening in your country, and people start to say, oh, this is how we're being looked at, or this is how this issue is being spoken about in other places. So, you know, until recently, it's something that sort of faded into the background in Italy. It's been, you know, I don't want to say that we're desensitized to the news that's happening right now, but it's no longer news. You know, it's like we've become very accustomed to hearing about these shipwrecks, to hearing about the hostility that some immigrants meet. Like, we're very, very used to hearing this now. So, you know, it's become almost normal, which means for us in making the film, you know, it wasn't this spectacular moment that we were trying to seize. It was very much trying to like negotiate and deal with something that to us is just like